Opening ELTR 1074, DC and AC rotating machinery. It's time for Unit 2, Week 2. We're going to start on Chapter 9, Motor Protection. We had two chapters this week, Chapter 9 and Chapter 3. Let's dive into motor protection. I'd like to start with a little bit of a rewind on basic concepts. Remember that the faster the motor spins, the more counter EMF there is generated inside the rotor or the armature of the motor. Therefore, the less net voltage from the source is pushing into the motor. Therefore, the less current is going through the motor. So the importance of that is we're going to be talking about overloads. And an overload literally is when there's too much of a mechanical load on the shaft. That in turn causes the shaft to slow, which reduces the generator effect in the rotor or armature, which reduces the counter EMF, which increases the net source voltage on the motor, which therefore increases the current through the motor. So my point is overloads lead to overcurrent, and overcurrent causes excessive heat, which will damage a motor. It can melt insulation. It can do all kinds of nasty things. And that's what this Chapter 9 is about protecting against ultimately that heat, which is sourced from the current, which sometimes is sourced from an overload condition. So let's dive in here and see what Chapter 9 looks like. As I just mentioned, in order to protect the motors from excessive heat, we have to protect them from overcurrents and overloads. Remember, overloads cause excessive current. And we use special overcurrent protection devices to make this happen. Fuses, circuit breakers, special thermal relays, etc. are used. And you could say these things, most of them, are thermally activated. They're specially devised and designed trip devices that open the circuit at a temperature that is earlier than the temperature that would cause a meltdown of the insulation. So that's the purpose of an overcurrent protection device. And in a nutshell, that's what they are. I don't know that I would call an overload as that temporary surge current when a motor starts. To me, that's more of an exemplification of momentary, temporary locked rotor current, which I guess you could say is an overload, but it's very temporary and transient. But still, an overload is when there's too much mechanical load on the shaft, and the motor will still try to drive, but what happens is the shaft slows, counter EMF reduces, so the current goes up. We have to protect against that. And quite simply, overcurrent is any current above what's considered the normal full load current design value, because if you run for extended periods of time above that value, you are going to create excessive temperature from excessive heat. This can be caused by at least three different things, overload being one, but also an internal short circuit in the wiring, typically between the windings of a coil, or also a ground fault, which is from a coil winding to the chassis. I know one thing you'll be doing in lab this week is disassembling motors, this week and next week, and probably through the rest of the semester. One thing you need to do is be cautious when you pull the rotor or the armature out of the case of the motor, especially for a wound armature. If you drag that accidentally, the windings against a piece of the frame, it will peel the insulation off and lay whiskers of copper from one winding to another, and this can cause a short circuit in the motor itself. Short circuits mean there's less resistance, actual copper resistance, therefore excessive current, therefore excessive heat and temperature. A ground fault is when you have a short circuit effectively from any of the windings to something connected to ground, be it conduit, a chassis of the motor, an enclosure of a box, whatever. That's a ground fault, a short to ground, and again, excessive current and excessive heat and high temperature. One general way to categorize overcurrent protection devices is to divide them into two categories, non-current limiting and current limiting. A non-current limiting overcurrent protection device will allow the current to build up to a fairly significant level before it opens. Current limiting means that there is some maximum current beyond which it's not going to go, and this thing is going to open before it hits that critical point. Fuses are more current limiting than circuit breakers are. And in fact, sometimes a circuit breaker, if the current is high enough, you will ionize the air between the contacts in the breaker, and even though the breaker opens, it will continue to conduct. This is not current limiting. Fuses, some, especially a Class T fuse, they'll open up and distinctly cause a limit in the maximum amount of current allowed to flow through that circuit. And following National Electrical Code criteria, all non-grounded conductors, your HOTs basically, have to be protected with some kind of overcurrent protection device, be it a fuse or a circuit breaker or both of those in series. A fuse is essentially an enclosed, what we call fusible link. It's a device made of a eutectic metal designed to melt at a certain temperature. And when it hit, when the conductor hits that temperature within the fuse, that element will melt and open the circuit. There are a lot of different styles of fuses. Here's a picture that shows just a few. The ones that look like a medium base lamp are your Edison base, and then we have a Type S, but there's all sorts of configurations of fuses. Pretty much the configuration determines how it's inserted into the circuit. Here are just a few more examples of the configurations of fuses. We have a cartridge fuse right here, which snaps into a clip type holder. We also have blade style connections for knife blade fuses as well. And these things can handle a lot of current. They're sometimes rated up to thousands of amperes of current before they trip. As we've mentioned before, motors do exhibit a surge current, or what's sometimes called the locked rotor current, for just a moment when they start up. And because of that, we don't want to have nuisance tripping of an overcurrent protection device every time you start a motor. So in the main circuits of a motor power input, we put what are called time delay fuses. A time delay fuse allows there to be an overcurrent of up to 800% for a short period of time before the thing trips and opens. That accommodates that very brief momentary surge current. However, sometimes in other situations, you're going to want instant tripping, and then you use a non-time delay fuse for that. Whereas fuses are one-time use overcurrent protection devices, circuit breakers can be reset and used multiple times. Effectively, they perform the same function, albeit maybe with different operating characteristics. And again, just like there are a number of different configurations of fuses, there are multiple configurations of circuit breakers, those configurations even differing on how they are operated, be they magnetic or thermal or mechanical. And just like we have time delay and non-time delay fuses, we have something similar to that in the world of circuit breakers. We have inverse time circuit breakers, and we have instantaneous trip circuit breakers. Instantaneous trip, like the name implies, when you hit that excessive current limit that it's designed for, boom, it trips. However, the inverse time works like this. It allows for an overcurrent condition for a period of time. The less the overcurrent, the longer the period of time before it trips. The greater the overcurrent, the shorter the period of time before it trips. So we have things like this to allow for design flexibility for very specific instances and applications of motors in industry and commercial settings. Both fuses and inverse time circuit breakers come in fairly standard units. And here's a little chart that shows you that at fairly standard voltage ratings. Here's an interrupt current rating phrase here. You should understand what the interrupt rating is for a fuse. It goes back to, like I was saying, a fuse or a circuit breaker, that sometimes if the current is really excessive and pretty instantaneously high, it will ionize the air between the contacts of the breaker and it will still conduct. So it's not interrupting current. The interrupt rating is how high of a current can you give it without it going into that condition. This is why sometimes we will put fuses in series with a circuit breaker, and the trip rating of the fuse will be maybe 50 to 100 degree or 100 amps higher than the breaker, because we don't want it to just necessarily trip right there. That's there as a backup for exceeding the interrupt rating of the breaker. And typically when we're doing that, we use what's called a Class T fuse. Now here's where we're starting to differentiate between overload and overcurrent. Again, if you look at the left side of this picture here, we don't want the fuses to nuisance trip when we start the motor. So these might be an inverse time sort of a thing, or a time delay sort of a thing that would prevent the nuisance tripping for that fraction of a second that the motor starts up. However, remember, an overload can create a current that is maybe a little bit lower, a little bit above, right around the exact amount of the full load rating, and over time it will get hot. So if we have a mechanical overload, which is going to cause excessive heat, we actually have overload protection devices, and they're called heaters because there's a little heater coil on the bottom of them that causes a thermal response in the overload protection device, which will force it to open. If there is an extended overload, we want it to go before the motor's damaged. Here's an example of that heater coil I mentioned that's in the overload protection device. The current going through here, that just looks like a little heater coil, and it will kick temperature up over a period of time. And the overload device itself is filled with a eutectic metal, something that melts at a fairly low temperature, relatively speaking. And it's also fairly constant. It's got a fixed melting point. So if there's an overload and if that thing gets a little bit hot, it will melt that eutectic alloy in there, and boom, it'll open the circuit and protect the motor from heat damage due to the overload condition. Some small motors actually have an overload protection device that's physically built right into the motor. One example of this is a refrigeration compressor motor for residential style refrigerator freezers. Here's another thing that will cause the counter EMF to go low and the current to go high. And that's what we call a brownout condition, or a low voltage condition coming in from ComEd. If I have low voltage, I'm not pushing sufficient current to give me sufficient torque to spin the motor up to full speed. Therefore, under that low voltage brownout condition with lower torque, the compressor of the refrigerator is going to cause the shaft to really drag and go slow. And even though the incoming voltage is low, the counter EMF goes way down, which means my net voltage on the motor under a brownout condition is actually higher, can be higher than when I'm giving it normal voltage. And if that counter EMF is low like that, that net voltage high, I will have excessive current and overheating if I have a brownout condition. And this is where you'll hear sometimes your refrigerator will make a little boink sound, boink, and it'll just stop. And as it cools down, you'll hear it go boink again. That's the bimetallic disc that's in there, and it'll reset and try to start. Sometimes it'll make that boinking noise off and on for several cycles after the voltage is up to full voltage, before it's cool enough to really safely operate. But this is fairly typical of small motors. And in addition to the heater style with the eutectic metal, we have three other types of overload relays. The first is an electromagnetic overload relay. The second is the electronic or solid state overload relay. And the third is a solid state overload relay that works with input from what are called current transformers, or CTs, that go near the line power lines feeding into the motor. So that is pretty much a wrap-up for Chapter 9. Again, like I told you earlier in the semester here, I'm not going to read the chapter to you. That's your job. My job is to hit what I consider to be the highlights, and that was what I thought was the highlights for Chapter 9. So we're going to break here, and we're going to come back and take a very ancillary look, a side view look, at Chapter 3 on AC alternators. Be back in a flash.